This background reading, Annihilation of Caste. This is an undelivered speech by Bhim Rao Ambedkar. Now, undelivered, this historical context must be clear that Bhim Rao Ambedkar was invited by Jat Pat Todak Mandal in Lahore. So Jat Pat Todak means an organization or a federation which is interested in annihilating caste or removing the caste system from the society. And it was the annual meeting of that organization in which Dr. Ambedkar was invited as a keynote speaker to deliver his speech. Now, Ambedkar came from Bombay to Lahore. He stayed there. I mean, just imagine, it was 1936, that period. Now, say 90 years ago or 85 years ago. So you can imagine the slowness of the speed of transport and other things. So he arrived well in times, few days before, and he was given hospitality. He stayed in a hotel, and then the organizers asked him to give them the text or the script which he was going to deliver in the organization's annual meeting. Dr. Ambedkar gave them the script. They read it, and after a day or two, they came back to him and they asked him to delete certain lines from the text because those lines were objectionable according to the organizations, according to Jat Pat Todak Singh. Now, Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar declined to compromise on his thoughts, on his thinking, and he refused to delete those lines. Now, can you imagine a guest, and he was not an ordinary guest. He had already done two PhDs from Columbia University and University of London, London School of Economics. And he was the most learned man of India in modern history. And that man is asked to go back without delivering the speech and without attending the meeting for which he was invited. And that's how the host behaved. The hosts who were interested in only their kind of ideas or ideology would not allow their guest to deliver his speech that had his own perspective. He came back. And this is how the speech remained undelivered. So this is one important aspect about this speech, that this speech became historical because after having been invited to deliver the speech as keynote speaker, and the event widely being publicized, and that is the period when the British were ruler, the organizers sent their speaker back, and their speaker was not an ordinary man. Even why should someone send back an ordinary man to after having invited. Ambedkar, for Ambedkar, academics, writing, reading, speaking was act of his political understanding of Indian society. It was not something that would enhance his status as a speaker. He came from the lowest caste, and having acquired the highest education in the world, he faced casteist discrimination in India. At that time, even today in metropolitan space, people unconsciously, directly, indirectly, did definitely inquire who you are and what is your caste and all kinds of those things, what you eat and not. And so you see, he had suffered heavily, and he had been humiliated, and he understood that the humiliation was not personal, but it came from the deeper social structures of Hindu society that was more concerned about the belief system that they carried from the past, and the certain shastras like Manusmriti that they carried from the past. And according to those shastras, the ideas of discrimination and humiliation for the low caste and the women were day-to-day declared or undeclared practices. So we know that the low caste or the untouchables were not low and not untouchable, but the certain shastras of the Hindus had maintained this position that people born in X, Y families would be given certain kind of jobs, and that job would be considered either low or high. And that according to the job, the people will also be considered low and high. So somehow, now even today we know that a job and a person, two are put together and there is no separation. There is no separation. Therefore, even it's very difficult to say which job is low. I mean, if we don't have cleaners in a town, then could the city live for 1 month if the cleaners don't take the garbage, and if gutters are not cleaned by these people? Can the city survive if they go on strike or if they leave that job for a month or two? I think there will be spread of diseases because of infection, and the city people will be suffering from variety of diseases and other problems like stinking smell and all that. But you see, these people are considered to be doing a low job and of low caste. So those who keep us healthy by getting into the unhygienic and filthy conditions, for them, our grading in the society is dubious and inhuman. So what we know from our actual behavior, that the social structure that maintains caste definitely maintains the standards which are for the upper caste and for the lower caste, and the jobs which are up for upper and for the lower. And this kind of hierarchy has humanized not only the economy of the particular people, but also the psychology. That is, they also capture them psychologically. If you keep on calling somebody low caste and not worthy to be touched for, let's say, generation after generation, definitely that person's psychological development will be hampered. And that person will start believing about himself that one is low. And in the body as well in the mind, different kinds of signs of inferiority will appear, manifest, and they will block even the development of intelligence, of development of emotional, emotionally belonging with the other people. So you see, this was a huge problem, and Ambedkar, having suffered himself and having known the casteist system and discriminatory caste practices first-handedly in his own life, was determined to speak about it, to challenge this silence, to break all kinds of norms or beliefs that were maintained historically for hundreds of years, whether it was about water or about body or about education or about food or about living a life of dignity. So he challenged all of these areas, and that was appreciated also world over. I mean, he may not have much following in India at that time, but his efforts and his thoughts were appreciated in the entire world. In America, in UK, in many countries of Europe, among blacks, among whites. So he knew what he was doing. And during that period, another very important public figure was Gandhi. So Gandhi too was against untouchability and caste system. So he developed the idea of Harijan. He developed the idea of self-cleanliness. He developed the idea of, self-realization. But he wanted to reform caste system, not annihilate it. Now that was the crucial conflict between Gandhi and Ambedkar. So what happened between Gandhi and Ambedkar? There was a huge debate for decades. Now, this is the whole environment. And this is the 20s, 30s, 40s, this period, and this is the most important period in the history, modern history of India, because freedom struggle is gaining momentum, and First World War had happened, okay, and the world was gearing towards it was coming out of depression of the 30s, a Great Depression, economic depression and all. And new ideas were evolving in the world. Russian Revolution had happened, okay, and freedom struggles all over the world were going on in different parts against the colonial rulers. In that situation, we see that he writes, he speaks, and he talks about not only of the British rule, but at the same time of the rulers within the society. So for him, Britishers, for him, within his own society, among Hindus, he was a Hindu, among Hindus, he felt that there was imperialism, there was a domination, there were ideas, there were beliefs that actually made us untouchable. Britishers would not call us untouchables. Britishers opened the door of education for the Dalits for the first time in India in modern history. Okay, so but within his own religion, within his own society, the doors for education were shut. Still, the people exercised those kind of rules which would not allow them to go to temple or go and have water from the public tap, or if they happen to touch someone on way, then they would be punished, and their houses will not be there in the central area of the village or the town, but will be built outskirts in a marginalized area. Their tasks would be to just work with the leftover, with the kind of services they have to render, which no one else will do. So, in that situation, he is a PhD in economics. On the basis of his research, Reserve Bank of India started Reserve Bank of India. Can you believe? We wrote one book, The Problems of Indian Rupee. And on the basis of that book, Reserve Bank of India was started by Britishers in India. Okay. So that there is always some reserve money, and there will not be more devaluation of money in the, because if you have some reverse reserve money, so devaluation doesn't happen. If you have reserve food, for example, for 6 months, so your anxiety for food will not be devaluated, or you will not be so anxious and anxiety ridden for food, because you know that you have it for 6 months and you can earn meaning during that time. So you see, you know now the context, that annihilation of caste, therefore, is part of a political ideology. It is part of not of any reform. He was not a reformist, and he did not want that Hindu religion and the caste and the society reform itself. He wanted that they should annihilate it. Annihilation was the condition. Annihilation was the condition, and he was very clear that in this regard, untouchability, for example, must go. There cannot be a reform in untouchability. It must go. Ideas about human beings in terms of leveling them as caste must go. You cannot have a reform that they can stay here and they can stay here. You can have your caste, but you should not exercise it in the public domain. He was very clear that the shastras he quoted in annihilation of caste, he quoted them, and then he argued, and then he proved that this system is inhuman. And this system does not go with any logic. And this system is irrational. And all arguments that are made in favor of caste system are illogical, not based on any fact, on any material reality, except that they are written in shastras, in a language, and they have a psychological impact. And that psychological impact makes some people privileged and other people unprivileged. And that division between them is used by the society for the supply of cheap labor. So he was very clear that the caste exists in India because this way we, the Dalits, or the oppressed, or the downtrodden, or the crest people are available for other at any time at the lowest price. If we are paid, fine. If we are not paid, fine. Because no, who touches us? We are worthy of nothing. We have no houses. We have no dignity. Our women do not have dignity, because when they go for work, they will be offered all that work which the upper caste people, or people who think that they are of high breeding, breed and high status. Okay, so he was very clear that it must be annihilated. So this is, you know, one very important point. And when we come back, we will get into the textual part and pick up something, some points, and see. We'll first begin with the role of rationality and role of logic in his writing, particularly Annihilation of Caste, and how this is so important for modern Indian writing. You see, how modern Indian writing will be informed, benefited, profited by a work called Annihilation of Caste and by the writings of B.R. Ambedkar. How does this writing in the background will build a background for us to inform our paper, Indian writing in English, modern Indian writing in English, that we would be further enabled to understand, to analyze, and to critically view the writings that we read.